Okay, so in this problem, we're going to take a look at multiple steady states and CSTRs. This is information that's available in most textbooks, for example, Fogler. However, we're going to take maybe a little bit of a different approach that's less algebra heavy to explore why multiple steady states occur and approaches for avoiding the occurrence of multiple steady states, or more importantly, for avoiding things like ignition or extinction. And we're going to try to avoid doing too much algebra here, although there will be a little bit. Okay, and so the setup here is that we have an adiabatic CSTR, and we're going to choose a simple reaction just so that the algebra is relatively simple, of A going to B. It's a liquid phase reaction, and it's an exothermic reaction, and we'll assume that the kinetics are elementary so that we can write the rate of reaction as being just K times CA. All right, and whenever we solve a problem where temperature effects can be important, we're going to want to solve both an energy balance and a material balance. Right, and the energy balance for an adiabatic CSTR is a relatively simple one. All right, we have two terms that are important. One is the fact that we have a reaction occurring, an exothermic reaction, that is going to tend to increase the reactor temperature. This is sometimes referred to as the heat generation term. Right, and the other term that we have is heat transfer through convection. So the fact that the temperature will change as between the entrance and the exit of the reactor. In other words, the reactor fluid will absorb the energy that's released by the reaction. And so we can express this maybe in a simplified form as being the sum of all components that flow in times their heat capacities times the temperature rise in the reactor. In our energy balance, these two terms have to balance. So all the energy that's released from the reaction has to be translated into an increase in temperature of the fluid, since we have no heat exchanger for this system. It's an adiabatic system. Okay, so that's our energy balance. We'll leave it in that form for now. We also need to do a CSTR material balance. We've done one similar to this many times, but we'll go through the quick outlines here. We have in minus out plus accumulation, which in this case is consumption of component A, is equal to zero. We want to work this, we've expressed this in terms of conversion, so we'll do the same here. This term is equal to, that's the amount of A consumed, which is equal to FA naught times X. I'm assuming liquid phase where we have constant density, we can relate the concentration of A to CA naught times 1 minus X times the volume. I'll take an additional step of saying, of noting that FA naught is equal to V naught times CA naught. And so I'm going to substitute that in here and then divide the entire equation by the volumetric flow rate in order to get the space time, which is sort of a convenient term. And I'm going to collect terms and not focus too much on the algebra here. We'll go get a 1 minus K tau is equal to K tau. Once we collect all our terms, and then that gives us material balance that we've seen before, actually, for a simple CSTR like this, where X is equal to K tau over 1 plus K tau. Okay, so here is our material balance. And what we want to look at is how our energy balance and material balance couple. And the place that they really couple is through X. And so we need to express how X depends on temperature here. And the way it depends on temperature in this kind of reactor is through the Arrhenius dependence of the rate constant. All right, so let's take this equation, and on the next page, we'll express it in terms of the Arrhenius constant. And if we just plug in the Arrhenius form, we get A times the exponential of negative E over RT times tau over 1 plus that same term. Okay, now we're going to look, just to get an idea for how this behaves, we're going to look at two limiting cases. Right, one is that if we're in the limit of low temperature, right, the limit of low temperature, this term, if we get low enough, this term will become very small compared to this term. Right, so at the limit that you approach 0 Kelvin, for example, this term has to approach 0, right, because the rate constant gets very low at very low temperature. Right, and so in that limit, then X varies exponentially with temperature, because the 1 becomes important in the denominator, and so you're just dividing this number by 1. So therefore, the temperature dependence of X is the Arrhenius temperature dependence, so an exponential rise. And then at the limit of high T, if we get to a high enough temperature, then this term will become much greater than 1. As T goes to infinity, this number will become infinitely large and dwarf 1. And so this ratio will effectively cancel out. We have this term over this term. And so we'll approach full conversion, which makes sense. If you get the temperature high enough, you'll convert all of your reactant to product in this irreversible reaction. So if we plot this up on an X versus T plot, all right, what we see is that we expect a exponential type dependence initially, but then a leveling off at a conversion of 1. Okay, so we get this sort of S-shaped curve. All right, what we want to do, this is our material balance. Now what we want to do is plot our energy balance on the same plot, because the reactor will actually operate at a point that satisfies both the energy balance and the material balance. So it'll be a point where the energy balance and material balance curves intersect. Okay, and our energy balance expresses X in terms of some constants, so FA naught. The heat of reaction can vary with temperature, but we'll assume that it is roughly constant, which is a pretty good assumption. The heat capacity, again, can vary some with temperature, but over a pretty good temperature range, it's roughly constant. And we'll assume that we're operating at fixed molar flow rates for this problem. In that case, what we have is a linear relationship between X and temperature. All right, so we expect a straight line rather than a type relationship rather than an S-type curve. Right, and so that line will start at T naught, and then as we increase conversion, we'll get a linear increase in the temperature. Okay, and that's our energy balance line. And I've drawn this in a particular place, right, where we get multiple intersections. All right, and this can give rise to multiple steady states. As is talked about in the textbook, this intermediate steady state is not stable. And that's because perturbations to the steady state will cause it to go to either the lower or the upper steady state. Right? So if you, for example, if you have a slight temperature variation to lower temperature, then you see the energy balance line is higher than the material balance line. And so that means that you're going to be removing heat faster than you can generate it from the reaction. And that will tend to force you down to the lower temperature steady state. Right, and this is discussed more in the textbook. These other two are inherently stable, however. Right, and so you could be operating at either one of those steady states, and it just depends on how the reactor has been started up. So typically, if you start up at low temperature, then you will be at the lower temperature steady state, and you'll have to actually ignite the reaction in order to go to the upper steady state. And so one way to do that, for example, would be to increase the value of T naught. The slope should still be roughly the same because all of those parameters were not very dependent on temperature. And so now we would be operating at the upper steady state. And if we lowered our feed temperature back, we'd still be there until we lowered it enough to get extinction. All right, so we see this sort of very simple behavior in a CSTR can lead to multiple steady states, and you need to account for those and really design your reactor and your startup in order to operate at the steady state that you want. Or you might try to design your reactor to ensure that you never achieve multiple steady states. One way that you can help to do that is to design heat exchange into your reactor. The effect of heat exchange, right, is that it will add a term to the right-hand side here. All right, so you'll have a term that's a heat transfer coefficient times the difference in temperature between a cooling fluid and your reactor fluid. And that will tend to have the effect of increasing the slope of your energy balance line, since the temperature won't change as much with conversion. So with heat transfer, you can increase your slope. And if you increase it above the maximum slope of the material balance line, then you can be certain to not have the existence of multiple steady states. Okay, the cause of the multiple steady states is, again, related to the nonlinear behavior of the conversion with respect to temperature. All right, so if we look at this more closely, and let's maybe do this on an Arrhenius plot. All right, we saw way back earlier in the course that we could understand the operation of a CSTR and other reactor types based on the area that we find on an Arrhenius plot. So we'll take a look at this in just a minute. What is important here is that we have two competing effects in an adiabatic reactor. All right, as the conversion goes up, right, we're going to expect this rate constant to also go up, because increasing the conversion is increasing the temperature inside the reactor because it's an exothermic reaction. And so that's going to go up. However, as we increase the conversion, the concentration goes down. Right? And so at some point, that effect will take over. If you consume all your A, it doesn't matter how quickly the rate constant is going up. Right? And so what this behavior leads to is a maximum, the ability to observe a maximum in the rate of reaction where these two effects are balanced. And so we can plot that up on this kind of Arrhenius type plot. And what you see is that that maximum creates a situation in which you can have two points, right, that have the same area associated with them on a Levenspiel plot. And again, the area of these different values associated with these different values of conversion, if they're equal, then both of them are stable steady states for the reaction. Because of these competing effects and the feedback into the reaction rate that you get from an exothermic type process, it's possible to observe multiple steady states. Right? Whereas this is much less likely in a plug flow type reactor because it's the area under the curve that's important in determining the operation of the reactor. And that area, as the conversion keeps increasing, always increases. Right? So in a CSTR, feedback effects are much more important.